you don't know how to run a startup because most of the successful startup are studying, let's say, Harvard or Stanford University. They have all the opportunity. And then you do the hardest thing in Vietnam, which is educating about pollution.
Wow.
Like,
which is
what
crazy.
The hell? Why would you put like the hardest thing in this country? It's so
yes.
hard.
So I see that you persevered a lot through all this, those times that you wanted to quit. I would like to know, before having all this idea, wanting like decrease this plastic pollution, what was your background before?
So I, long story. So I'm more in sales and marketing area. So I started my career in sales. Because I believe that this is a soft skills that I really need. I really need to communicate with people in the right way. I need to sell my ideas, sell my products, and just talk to people. And so I honed these skills skill sets quite well until like I say after 3-4 years in that area. So then I was like, I really. Inspired by marketing and branding because I watch a lot of Mad Men. This show is so good. So I watch a lot of Mad Men. I got, you know, a little bit brainwashed. I was like, I want to do branding because when I do sale, I was like, just, you know, there's a soldier, just go there and buy and sell and get the target and then you get promotion and then you got commission, which is great. But then why we communicate such idea message to the person, I don't know. So I went to explore that part, and that's why I moved from Hanoi to Saigon, working for Grey Group, which is quite reputable advertising agency.
Okay.
So at that time, I was account manager. So again, talk a lot to clients, so client servicing, and also have a chance to work with strategic planner, thinking about what idea should we sell to the user people. Then talk and work with creative side. So I learned a lot during that 2 years at Grey. I mean, 2 years at Grey is like 5 years at other company because at one point I managed 6 clients at the same time. So various area from bank to medicine to beer to
everything basically.
You know, Vingroup, Vinhome, this all my clients. So at some point I was like, at some point it's getting boring because I started to understand the process of creating a brand and how to attract, to talk to, how to get the inside of people. Still it's a long process to learn, but I know the process roughly. And I started to read, I read a book named 4-Hour Workweek by Tim Ferriss. So highly recommended to watch and to read that.
Okay.
So I was like, I really want to do something for myself. So let's see what is it's what can be the passive income, right? Because it's mentioned. And so I realized that I moved to Saigon for almost 2 years and I still rented a bike, a scooter. So if I am a Vietnamese, I know what the good bike is.
Yes.
And I still rent a damn bike from other people.
Yeah.
Why don't I just do it?
Yeah, the market here is crazy, guys, for the bikes.
Yeah, so I actually have a, during the time, and also I realized that anytime I get money, I just spend most of my salary on drinking. Because, you know, when we're young, we just drink a lot. Lots of happy hour. Lots of happy hour, lots of lady nights. So, even though we still spend.
Lots of nightlife.
Yeah.
Nightlife.
It's very cheap here.
Yes.
Get drunk, get really drunk. And yeah, I felt like I just live for the weekend and go to a rat race in a way. So I was like, let's you know, quit again. But before we quit, let's try to, you know, do some, have some kind of income before I quit. So every time, so I remember for the 6 months, every time I got salary, I just, half of the salary I buy a scooter, I bought a scooter, and then I rent it out, and then half of the salary I try to pay my rent and live very cheap, no more drinking, or much less. Then I continue for 6 months and I have like 6 clients. Every month I have one more client. So I have like $250 per month as I know that that's my passive income. It will keep coming in. And then I quit my job. I maxed out my credit card twice just to buy more scooter.
Wow. mm-hmm.
And then luckily I got another job. They pay me quite well. So I worked for that job, keep my scooter business. And then whenever I have money for my salary, I reinvest back to my scooter business. So it's, yeah, it's like keep investing. So I learned about personal budgeting, financing.
Yeah, very smart.
And reinvesting money. Don't spend on drinking anymore.
So I would like to know now, you had so many low moments, low lows, right? And what made you stand up again when you felt that it was the end for you, because you wanted to quit, to give up on IACF twice? Can you describe me the feeling that you had and what just helped you to stand up again?
Yeah, I think we as also female and entrepreneur, when you are alone, you don't have somebody else to kick your ass or support you, right? So when I'm down, I would self-talk in a very negative way, like Ling is, you don't know how to do what to do, you don't have any background in you know, finance, so you can't even control your cash, you don't know how to run a startup, because most of the successful startup are, you know, study in let's say Harvard or Stanford University. They have all the opportunity, and then you do the hardest thing in Vietnam, which is educating about pollution.
Wow.
Like, what the hell? Why would you put like the hardest thing in this country? It's so hard. Working for bank, for finance, easier. You have job laid out and you don't even take them. Now the COVID, nobody wants to hire you anymore because they have so many layoffs. So what are you doing here right now, Ling? So so lots of like self-doubt, self-talk, negative, so low. And when I realized that is normally when I wake up, I don't wake up right away. I lie in my bed. I watch all the YouTube, all the motivational YouTube videos.
Still
doesn't work. Instagram, all that. Spend so much time on that. Trying to wake up at like 12, get food. And then I was like, oh, I still have money for food, how? So, and then I try to work, but not very productive. And that could happen for a few days. Sometimes it can be 1 or 2 weeks. And when I look back, I was like, this is so bad. So at that moment, I was like, you know what? Maybe I just go to talk to my clients. Let's see, go to the shop owner and see what they tell me, because I haven't seen them for a long time. So I went there and I said, hey, how is it going? And they're like, oh, people love your cup so much. Look at all the messaging.
Yeah,
they're doing these things. It's like, huh, so actually people like it.
It gives you a smile, right?
And I was like, huh, I'm helping people. So that was like, okay, I came back and have plans. So I write out plans and goals. And
okay.
So I think plan and goal could be something that you need to stick on.
Okay, so every time you felt low, you were just searching for feedbacks for someone to tell you, okay, how is it now?
I would say if you haven't launched, then it's quite hard to see if you if you have client or not. But if somebody already using your product or using your services, just go there and then sit down and talk to them, because they also have low time. And they are so happy that you are there to support them. And then when you have low time, you go there and say, I don't know if it's gonna work, and they say, no, it's actually work. Look at this, the people sending me message to get your cups. So please don't stop. So at least 1 or 2 person say, please don't stop. That would give me a huge boost, and go back and like, okay, let's refine. You know, the landing page is it's not good. The social media has nothing. So like, try to figure out what's the problem, what is priority, and go back to it.
In which area did you have the most difficulties?
I think everywhere. So the priority, the core of the product of the network is the cups need to be nice and beautiful, attract people, which we have that in the first batch of the cup, our first edition. The second is the network need to be big. I didn't have enough people to help me to do that. And then the third one would be the app, nice and easy enough to work around, and that would create a, let's say, network effect, the fancy word it is, or it's create more value to the user, so more value to the shop owners. So that could be the three areas I want to focus very hard next time, soon.
So did you learn a lot since?
So I look back, so, you know, our investor back in Hanoi, who had to work with the government, who had to do like a huge report for lots of pages, like almost 200 pages, right? Mm-hmm. So actually that quite a nice exercise to just go through all the achievement that you get, mm-hmm. I got. Like, we've been picked up by 13 different news in 5 different videos, or TV. I was like, huh, that's great. And then it's actually lots, like we won lots of craft pitching competition awards, Asian challenge. We went to Thailand. We went to Thailand. The people give us money to go there and got training. I was like, huh, it's actually great. So lots of, you know, when you look through the timeline, you say, oh, we have done a lot. But also as a founders, and sometimes we just self-doubt ourselves and underestimate, and then you just stuck with your own spiral, just go down and go down like that. And sometimes you have to look back and see your achievement, and then go get back up.
Yeah. Through this process of making AyaCup, did you have someone a shoulder, or were you by your very own?
Almost.
You would say.
No.
You were very by your own, right?
Yeah, so some people come in, they say, oh, we're interested in you, we want to work with you, and I was, yeah, sure, come join. Mm-hmm. And then at some point they started to say mean thing to you.
Okay.
Yeah. Or some people call themselves as the mentor, and then they come in and then they can stab you mentally. Say bad things, make you feel like more insecure.
Yes.
So you need to be very strong and make boundaries.
Make boundaries.
And boundaries.
And the most important thing is, it doesn't mean that this guy or this woman is a mentor, that it means that he knows more than you.
No.
And it's not because you just start now that he will give you good advice. And that's what I've learned too. Mm-hmm. That's crazy, right? It's a crazy road. What was the worst disappointment that you have with a mentor?
I choose my mentor quite wisely. I attest them a lot to. Not all of them can be my mentor, because that word is very special for me. And when I give it to somebody, I really meant it. So I don't have much problem. But I would say people wanted to be my mentor, and then I was okay. Sit down, tell me what you know, mentor. If you're my mentor, then you at least have to be very good at one area. I don't mean that you know everything, but let's say you are a mentor in design, then you have to be, what concept you have done? I do like an interview. What have you done? What's your projects? What do you think about this? What do you think about that? How would you develop this cup, for example? And then if they talk something that I find like this is very boring, and it's like, no, bye-bye. And then somebody have never been my mentor officially, that I just come to them with questions, then and they give me a lot of very broad new idea, because they are so expert in
insight.
That area insight. So they just become my, you know, silent mentor.
I think it's better when we actually reach them, because we choose them, and then we know what we want to expect, kind of.
And you probably also have lots of like suggestions from experts, right?
Yes.
And then they just know you for 5 minutes, and you run your business for a year. What can they say much? It's unfair to tell them, to ask them for suggestion, because they don't know.
Yes.
So unless they follow you, you have to give them a good presentation, tell them really good your problem. Then they can give some suggestions and advice, and maybe they can give you some connection that you need. And I think that's what you really meant to.